Steve Mobley. Steve became involved in politics in 2009 while many were getting started forming Tea Party groups. Steve chose a slightly different route. In a special election for state senate seat, Steve challenged the entire state political establishment system when he ran as an independent candidate for the seat. A virtual unknown, he raised eyebrows across the state when he ran and took on the status quo, earning 3.5% of the vote. In 2010, Steve ran for the Michigan House as a Republican. With minimal financial support, because of his 2009 race, Steve came within 10 points of beating a well-established, well-liked, and well-funded Democratic candidate. In 2012, Steve was the campaign director for Jack Hogan as he tried to unseat a 24-year moderate incumbent Democrat. Steve was the state grassroots director for the Herman Cain presidential team. He worked with the campaign to defeat Barack Obama on their bus tour through Michigan last year. And as a citizen lobbyist, advocate, and citizen. He spent many days in Madison. Steve was part of the Freedom to Work Up and was one of the founding members of the Calhoun County Tea Party Patriots. Steve is currently the director of the Deputy Director of the Madison Project, CAC, and he and his wife, Michelle, live in Madison. Please join with me in welcoming Steve to our podium.
Thank you, Jerry. I'm going to set this down for just a second.
I give myself a position.
Thank you for the introduction, Jerry. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm a friend of Bill's, and we've talked for the last several months about me coming over here and having an opportunity to speak to you folks. And I'm honored to be here. Service members, let me tell you this, as a father of a son that he is currently serving with our armed forces in Afghanistan. I'm a native of Oakland County, so I'm familiar with the east side of the state, and it's always good to come home. But I'm not here tonight to tell you about me. And you hit it on the head. Somebody would look at that little bio that was out there and say, what a loser. He runs for office, he loses. He runs for office, he loses. He tries to help somebody else run for office, he loses. Now, I'm somebody that doesn't want to quit. I've been around the state the last few months talking with Tea Party groups, conservative groups, and at the beginning of the year, I saw numbers kind of dwindling. There was a lot of disappointment in what we went through a year ago. But with what we're seeing in Washington and what we're seeing even here in Michigan in the last few months, from those that call themselves Republicans, I'm seeing a resurgence of energy and dedication to keep up the fight. And that's part of what I want to talk to you tonight about. As I start things off, I'm going to pass this assignment sheet around. You're welcome to sign it if you want, and not sign it if you don't want. How many of you are familiar with a gentleman named Jack Hogan? How many of you get an email called Core Principles? Core Principles is the newsletter of the Madison Project Michigan PAC. We currently have somewhere around 12,000 subscribers across the state and even across the country. If you'd like to get our emails, which will keep you updated on what's going on in Lansing, give you calls to action, let you know of things that are coming down the pipe, feel free to sign up. So what is the Madison Project? Our values are very simple. We are pro-life, pro-family, limited government, and defenders of religious freedom, period. That seems to be the popular thing lately, isn't it? Period. Our mission, to evaluate every state house and senate race in Michigan and only endorse viable candidates who, in races, who clearly demonstrate their conservative values. Candidates who do not demonstrate both social and fiscal conservatism will not be considered. Let me share with you a little bit. The way that I look at it right now, no seat is off limits. I'll show you a little bit of information coming up here shortly. But with what we're seeing, it's time for us to take action. You know, when the Tea Party was formed, it stood for what? Tax enough already. Well, I think we're seeing a move into something else. Same three letters, but it's taking the effective action. We're no longer just holding meetings. We're no longer just going to rallies. We're getting involved. I know a number of people across the state that started out in groups just like this. They now spend sometimes 3 days a week in Lansing lobbying on our behalf. Nobody pays them. Nobody gives them a ride. Nobody buys them lunch. They're up there knocking on the doors of our legislators, trying to hold them accountable. We need to do that every day. Our current status in Michigan, or the current political climate, we have a Republican governor. We have a Republican majority in the House. And we have a supermajority in the Senate. Is that good enough? I think what we've seen lately in Washington and in Lansing, we know that's not the truth. It's not good enough. An example, somebody remember back in February, a little bill called House Bill 4111, designed to set up the Obamacare exchange. It was defeated by the Senate. It passed in the House. 29 Republicans voted in favor of passing Obamacare exchange in Michigan. It's not good, folks. So the question I want to pose to you is, do we need to increase the quantity of Republicans that are in our legislature? Or do we need to look at improving the quality of the people we elect to represent us? I would dare to say we need to improve the quality. Next slide. So how do we do that? Well, there's a couple ways. First, we can make them behave. I like to refer to it as puppy training. And I can tell you from experience, this works for a while. And I would like to refer it to a story I heard of a psychologist that was at a dinner party talking about puppy training his new puppy. And he said it worked for a while. He'd pee on the floor, I'd take the newspaper, I'd slide him on the bucket, I'd throw him out the little flip door at the bottom. After a while, he'd pee on the floor and he'd run out the door. It works for a while, but we're already starting to see with what happened just the last couple of weeks, a voice vote. Nobody having the guts to stand up, and which they're right as a member of the legislature to say, we want a roll call vote. Nobody stood up and demanded a roll call vote. We need some people with some guts. A gentleman by the name of Milton Friedman. I do not believe the solution to our problem is simply to elect the right people. The important thing is to establish a political climate of opinion which will make it politically profitable for the wrong people to do the right thing. Unless it is politically profitable for the wrong people to do the right people will not do the right thing either. Or if they try, they will shortly be out of office. How many know of a gentleman named Senator Ted Cruz? has stood his ground through everything that's going on and has been just literally assassinated for standing his ground. There were a number of other people that in the early stages were standing right there with him. They don't seem to be there anymore. It's not politically profitable. We need to make it politically profitable for the wrong people to do the right things. Because when it's easier to not do the right things, unless you have strong principles to stand on, you'll find yourself doing the wrong things. Someone else said it very well. When you can't make them see the light, make them feel the heat. And that's what we've been doing. That's what a number of people just like you have been doing when they go to Langston. With some of the rallies that have been held up there, going up there and lobbying on behalf of all of us. We've seen the difference. But there's an even better thing. That's to elect full-spectrum conservatives. You know, when our country was founded, we had an electorate that was very well informed. Unfortunately, like Paul Harvey said, we're not well informed. The vast majority. We're seeing that change, but we're a long ways from where we were and what we should do. So we need to, because most of us have responsibilities, most of us have things that we have to do every day. We can't afford to spend our days in Lansing or in Washington babysitting those that we elect to represent us. So we need to elect people that we can count on, that even when things get tough, that they will stand on the principles. At the very least, that they will stand on a platform of what we call the Republican Party. We're seeing it time and time again to where they're not even standing on the platform of the party that the people elected them. What do we get? They're left with nothing. So where are our efforts and resources best spent? In the open seats. There truly are three parties in our political system. There is the Republican Party, there is the Democratic Party, and there is the incumbent party. The incumbent party, those that are already in office. It is very difficult, almost impossible, to unseat an incumbent. The benefit that we have in Michigan is we have term limits, so they are not allowed to stay there indefinitely. In Washington, it's a different story. But until we, the people, take over our responsibility or take back our responsibility of voting the way that we should and increase the numbers that turn out to vote, instead of it being a minority of the people voting, it should be a majority of the people. We have to rely on things like term limits to do the job for us. We need to push for that. But it's very difficult to unseat an incumbent. There's a couple of reasons for that. One is what happens up inside the building, whether it's in Lansing or Washington. There are little groups called the lobbying groups. And they get to know these guys. And they get a good relationship going. And I'm not saying that all lobbyists are bad. There are some that are good, there are some that aren't. But it's a whole lot easier for them to work with somebody that they know, that they have to deal with new people all the time. We can't afford to have people up there all the time like they can. There are a number of seats that are considered open, and that is constantly changing because we've had at least one state senator that has decided not to run for re-election, and we've got some state representatives that are switching from, instead of running for their third term, they're going to run for some state senate seats. So this is constantly evolving. But as of earlier this year, we had approximately 17 seats that were classified as open. That means that the person that is currently serving in that seat is on their final term and is not eligible to run again. So that makes it an open seat. There's about 17 in the House, there were 5 or 6 in the Senate. Could go on to the next one. And one more. There were a couple of those up there that had a D next to them. There's currently a Democrat in that seat. But that seat is not always a Democratic seat. It's a seat that has gone back and forth. So we have an opportunity to have a tremendous impact and put some solid conservatives up in Lansing. So how can you help us elect more constitutional conservatives to the legislature? Help us identify good candidates. A good candidate needs to be somebody that's articulate, somebody that can speak their mind and say it well, a statesman. They need to know the issues. They need to be somebody that's not a bomb thrower. Now, somebody said, well, what about Rand Paul? He throws bombs all the time, but he knows the issues and he knows how to speak. He's a statesman. There's a difference. Ted Cruz is another good example. He knows the issues. Just throwing out zingers out there, one-liners, sound bites, that's not what we're looking for. We need people that are solid in what they believe and how to stand on it and present it to others. They need to be somebody that's willing to work hard. I can tell you from my own experience. And I'm sure that Representative Daley back there. Yeah, I see you. Thanks for being here today. And Senator Kavanaugh, is that correct? Yes, there you are. I thought I saw you today. They can walk a test. You don't win an election by sitting in the living room. Knocking on doors, working long hours, it's not for the faint heart. It takes a lot of work. It really does. It's a stress on the family. It's a stress on every aspect of your life. I probably worked harder running for office than I did in 21 years working in the manufacturing industry. And I worked right on all the floor. I know what it's like to work hard every day. So we need people that are willing to do that. And they need to raise money. They need to have the ability to raise money. There are two things involved in a campaign. Number one thing is money. And when you get that done and out of the way, the second thing is you need money. We're going to see some races this year for state seats, either the Senate or the House. They could easily run up in the neighborhood of $250,000. It's all right. It doesn't compare to some of the national races, but that's a lot of money. And they've got to be able to do it. And I think both of our legislators here would agree one of the hardest things to do is ask people for money. But it's a necessity. If you were even watching part of the television during the last election cycle, or spending any time listening to the radio, it's all you heard. It takes a lot. And so a good candidate, needs to have that ability. It doesn't mean that it's easy, but it means that they're willing to work at it. Some other things that you can do to help us? Communicate. Just like what you're doing here. You've got this meeting, you've got a morning meeting that you have. You get the word out. You share the information. The postcards, all of those things help communicate the message. You can help Madison Project by liking us on Facebook. You can follow us on Twitter. Oh, by the way, that reminds me. I have to do my due diligence here. First that I was here, Everybody can smile and wave. This will be on Twitter later tonight, letting people know I was up here and here. And you can share that information with others. Stay connected. Sign up for our email just like I asked you to. Welcome to Madison Project Michigan. Got this handy dandy little flyer right here. Tells you what Madison Project is all about. On the back side, for your convenience and to save money on trees. See, we're green. We use both sides of the paper. Nice little donation card. Nice thing about Madison Project, we are a PAC in the state of Michigan. We are a political action committee. We have the ability to give more money to candidates than you do as an individual. And by donating to Madison Project, not only are you helping your local candidate, but you can help us win seats all over the state of Michigan. And I have been authorized to anyone that does make a donation of $25 or more tonight to Madison Project. We have this wonderful little bumper sticker. It says MadisonProjectMichigan.com, supporting real Republicans in 14. Involve us to get involved. Don't be afraid to talk to people. Help us identify more conservative voters. You'd be amazed how many people out there are truly conservative that still don't vote. The reason they don't vote, it hasn't affected them yet. We're not far from that happening. We need to get ahead of the game. We need to be ahead of this and get them involved now. Invite them to the party. Make it fun. You know, what you guys did for the veterans, that's awesome. Those kinds of things, you can get other people involved. Start talking to your friends, your family, people at church, people you work with. Find out where they're at. Start helping change minds. Those are the things that you can do. I appreciate the opportunity to be here. We have a lot of work to do. I thank you folks for all you're doing. For what you have done. And as we continue this work together, we can improve the quality of those that represent us and know that they're going to stand on the principles that we all believe in. Thank you very much. I have mixed emotions about the former governor. I think she made the ticket in 2008 because without her, I don't think I would have voted for John McCain. I fully respect what she did when she resigned from the governorship. As hard as it was to accept, I think she showed a lot of stamina because of everything that she had gone through and what she knew was going to happen because she had already announced she was not going to run for re-election. She made a very wise move to get the state to continue to move forward, and I applaud her for that. And it also freed her up to be able to go on and do what she's doing now.
to be a voice for us. So.
Don't you think she was a political martyr? I mean, I am, the way people slandered her, and none of the Republicans stood up and attacked her, except Paul Greenberg.
I don't know that I would call her a martyr. I think she was more of a sacrificial.
Same thing.
If she gave herself for it, I don't think it was totally willingly done. But I think she handled herself very well.
Thank you for that question. We have four of them over here, too. Anybody else have any other questions for Roger?
In some of these, what you're calling open seats, should your candidate not win the primary, would you then continue to support the Republican candidate in that position?
Right now, we are focusing primarily on the primaries because in the majority of these seats, the election is won during the primary. Many of these seats are what most would consider to be fairly solid or Republican-leaning districts, and in many of those cases, the election is won during the primary. We are only supporting candidates who measure up to the standards that we set. So, saying that, if we support a candidate in a race and that candidate does not win, then our job in that race is finished. We're focusing primarily on the primaries. We may be involved in some of the general elections. And while there is a whole list of seats that are available, that does not necessarily mean that we will be involved in every one. That also is not to say that we may not get involved in something that wasn't on that list. We're going to evaluate each and every seat on a seat-by-seat basis. We will support the candidates. There may be seats where we have two extremely good candidates that are running for the seat, and we see them as equally qualified. We may let them just work it out between the two of them and run the race. In my opinion, that is probably the best thing to do in that situation because iron sharpens iron. The best way to get prepared for a general election is to have a tough problem and to be sharpened by your opponent. And if it's a race between two equals, there's no reason for us to be involved. If it's a situation of someone that is a true, solid conservative versus someone that is not or that claims to be, then we'll do everything we can to help that candidate.
Anybody else? Wait a minute, Carol, we're behind you.
One of the problems that I have noticed during the primary is there may be a very good candidate running. However, I have heard from people of our Democrats or whatever, they will vote in the Republican primary for the worst person in the general election, and we get threat when it comes to voting. We had that with McCain, and we had that with Romney, wasn't quite as bad, but I have seen on the internet people commenting, well, I didn't go vote because two bad issues, why bother? So the people that didn't vote, in my mind, voted for Obama.
Well, unfortunately, in our system in Michigan, we have, you call it what you want, but it's an open primary. Since there is no official registering of a political affiliation, other than when you walk into the polling place on a primary day and you say, I want a Republican candidate or I want a Democratic candidate, there is no way to control that in an open system. We used to have, if I remember correctly, registration part of the affiliation issue. We don't have that anymore. Other than we do not have to pick up the ballot.
The only way that we can stop that from happening is to go back to a registered system. Some people think it's a good idea, some people don't. Some people think that forcing the person to register with one party or the other alienates those that call themselves independents. I think it would be something that the people of the state should decide. But until we can change our system to something that is controlled in that nature, we're going to have that situation happen. Especially when we see with some regularity that in a lot of seats, there's no challenge for the Democrat. A Democrat will run. And if you only have one Democrat running in the primary and two Republicans, Democrats don't have to vote for the Democrat because they're going to win already. So they can go do that kind of stuff. Do I think it's fair? No. But it's the reality of the world we live in. And that's why we need to work to educate more people.
Anybody else? Questions? First speaker? Coming behind you with a microphone.
Steve, for a minute about Madison Project nationally as in other states. If we donate at Michigan on the local level here in Michigan, does that money flow out to other states? Or if you want to donate to national campaigns, is there a national group you would donate to?
Good question. Madison Project started out as a national organization. They really came into prominence in the last couple of election cycles. But they've been around for about 20 plus years. After the 2012 election, they started to recognize, in my opinion, what a lot of many of us are seeing, and that is the problem in Washington is not something that we want to fix soon. As much as we would like to, harsh reality is Washington is Washington, and it's not going to change overnight. It didn't get there overnight, it's not going to change back overnight. So what we need to do is we need to do two things. We need to build a wall of defense from the overreaching government in Washington, and that's at the state level. See, what the federal government has forgotten, and what a number of the states have not quite yet acknowledged, is the states have the power. There's a short little phrase I like to refer to. Says the powers not delegated to the United States by the Constitution, nor prohibited by it to the states, are reserved to the states respectively or to the people. The Ten Commandments. The states have the ultimate authority over the federal government. The states refuse to exercise their constitutional rights. Because in many cases, the states have sold out to the money pool. Medicaid expansion, if we don't take the money, somebody else will get it. We need to reinforce that. So the National Project started about 20 years ago. At the end of the election, they realized we needed to do two things. One, set that wall of defense. Number two is to start building an armed team of solid conservatives to bring up through the ranks. So while we are part of the Madison Project, we are a separate organization. There are laws that prohibit us from being, you know, tied with the national organization. We're a state factor, a federal factor. The money that is donated to Madison Project Michigan stays in Michigan and will help conservatives in Michigan. And what we hope to do over the next few election cycles years to come, as we head this organization, we're going to bring it all the way down. Township trustee, dog catcher, school board member, so that we can bring conservatives in to the field and raise up a generation of fighters to take our places and create a solid project.
What do y'all think? Anybody have any more questions? If not, we got excuse me, a couple of elected officials here to hear from you. Maybe you do have a question. Question is, can you tell about us about the Young Republicans and what they stand for?
The Young Republicans are an organization that is designed to help reach out to younger people, whether it's through the teenage Republicans, college Republicans, young Republicans, it's to reach out to the younger generation. I see we've got a few that are a little bit younger in here, but if you look around the room, there's not too many. And there are a lot of conservative kids out there. And so their goal is to help bring them in and get them involved in the Republican Party. We need to reach out to them too, because a lot of them are conservative, especially when they see what's happening. They begin to realize that the effects of what our government is doing is going to affect their paycheck for the rest of their lives as well, and their kids' lives, and themselves.
Anybody else? We'd like to thank our speaker for being here this evening. We do have a couple of elected officials, as I told you about earlier here tonight, that would like to speak to you about a topic or two or three. First, let me introduce you to Senator Bill Pavlov. Did you know you were speaking?
Sorry.
Okay. You're not at a loss for words.
Thank you all. Welcome to the Fair Commons meeting. Thanks for the presentation today. Give Jack my best. I had the fortunate or unfortunate opportunity to serve several years in the Michigan office with Jack. I got a call last week from the Bill Gavette and asked me to come in there and talk a little bit about the process on the Common Core resolution that moves through the Senate. Steve touched on it earlier in his remarks. Essentially, what happened was that I'm going to go back to the budget conversation in June when the budget was being resolved. And there was an amendment that was put into the state budget that would put a freeze on the spending that the state of Michigan would do in implementing the Common Core. Now, that was kind of put in there as not necessarily a last resort to put a clamp on the funding, but it was essentially done to have a long summer conversation on what's Michigan's direction going to be on the Common Core. To give you a little bit of history, the Common Core state standards are exactly what they are, state standards. And the state standards were adopted by the State Board of Education in 2010. And they're being taught in every classroom in the state of Michigan, over 100,000 classrooms. These standards have been implemented. We are now getting to the point in Michigan where we're going to have to come up with a test. I want to separate the assessment piece from the standards piece. It gets a little bit complicated to try to follow in. I'll help answer any of the questions that you have on it. The standards are a set. Think about it as a ruler with the numbers on, with benchmarks on the ruler. The curriculum, the two Common Core state standards and Common Core curriculum, there is no such thing as a Common Core curriculum. The curriculum is determined at the school district level, where directors will get together and match up the course content that they believe they need to use for instruction. instructions to match up with the metric stick that's going to be applied to the education of that child, 3rd through 11th grade. So keep the standards in one piece, one side of your brain, and the curriculum on the other. Every one of the curriculums that are designed to get to the benchmark have been approved at the local level, at your school board level. Now, the pathway that I was on, I chaired the Senate Education Committee, and one of the biggest issues that we have to deal with is getting the assessment piece right. In other words, what will the questions be on the test that we're trying to measure the effectiveness of the education our kids are getting in the state of Michigan? And so I was working all summer long, and I took a partner in this project named Pat Kolbeck. And if you know who Pat Kolbeck is, he represents Western Wayne County in the Michigan Senate. Pat is a very intelligent guy who understands measurements, metrics, and assessments. So him and I got together and put together a proposal for our leadership, for the administration, as a solution to what was going to be initially, essentially, voted on for state standards of funding. Sounds complicated, let me break it down for you. The only way that Michigan can control the outcome and the questions is to be able to have a test that we can control, a Michigan test, a Michigan assessment. And what you see in Georgia and Iowa and some of the other states that have pulled away from the Smarter Balance Assessment Test, these states are now on a pathway to develop their own assessment tool. So the system that the department is working on right now and implementing is a consortium. And there are 14 states that are in this testing system. What ends up happening is if you find out in 2 or 3 years that second grade reading is taking a 30% dive, 5th, 6th, and 7th math and science scores are down, there isn't anything that we can do to adjust that testing system unless we take the time, stop the clock, and get an assessment tool that we can control at the state level, whether we do the Department of Ed or the Michigan Legislature. So the assessment tool that we continue to work on, I talked to Patrick Kovac about it this morning, we will be introducing legislation requiring the Department of Education to go out and bid for a testing system or develop their own that meets all these criteria for control that is a state issue. Steve talked a little bit about the 10th Amendment. State rights are a huge issue. And so when we work to try to find a solution, we're not clearly focused on the assessment. The Common Core state standards are in place. They have been adopted. And there wasn't anything in the budget bill that obviously we voted for to stop the Common Core funding that was ever going to change that standard in every classroom in the state of Michigan. The only way that we can control what's getting taught in our schools is to be able to build a firewall. And that firewall is designed to be able to have the assessment piece here and the content flow down to the flow chart, thereby controlling parts of the curriculum and parts of the Common Core state standard. It sounds very complicated. I was one of the people that was opposed to it. I had 2 record roll call votes in opposition to it. We didn't have an opportunity in the Senate to put up a voice vote or to put up a record roll call vote. It was a leadership decision. I was asked by our leader to continue working on the assessment piece, where I truly believe we can get the control that we need in case things go bad. Right now, the state of Michigan has 5 different assessment tools. We need to get the right one assessment tool. I'm going to go through a couple of them right now that we're trying to eliminate and what we're trying to implement. We rank schools on top to bottom. 4,300 schools are listed, 1 through 4,300. We also have a complicated color code system that just went into place. So we rank our schools by color. anybody want to guess if their student was going to a lime green school, if that a good school or a bad school? We are working right now with the house, the bill is moving out of the house right now, to evaluate our schools. A, B, C, D, and E. That's something everybody can understand. So if your student is going to a D school, you're going to know as a parent. You might not know how good that school is performing if it's a lime green fund. We have the lowest 5% rankings of our schools. So we take all 4,000 of those schools and then we measure the very bottom 5% of the schools. Right now, there are about 160 schools, plus or minus a few, every year that are on that lowest achieving level. What we're trying to attempt to do is to get an assessment tool that's in place that does a lot of things. Number one, measure our kids for effectiveness, allow that local control of the curriculum to continue, but still have a standard. And the way that I've explained it is that you have what's above the waterline. Figure a ship going through the lake. What's above the waterline is what you can see. And those are the measurements. Those are you meeting third grade reading levels? Are your math and science school scores consistent with the outcome that you want to have? Because there isn't anything wrong with having a standard. You must have a standard. And again, I continue to look at these standards as not curriculum because they are not curriculum. Standard is, what are you measuring? How you get to it, not so much as the why, but it's the what. And we can control that through the proper assessment. And it might take an additional year to get the bidding process in place with the department, but we can have something that we can control, that we can monitor. You know, we still operate under the NEET test in the state of Michigan. The NEET test has been a very troubled process for measuring our students' performance. We cannot get past the fact that, you know, the worldwide ranking, we're between 17 and 25 worldwide in terms of what we know for math and science and reading, the basics of public education. Those are not getting delivered. I've never been one to believe that you can test the prosperity. I've always believed that you can educate the prosperity. But we have to be able to give the tools to measure. And so think of the Common Core as the standard for measurement, but there's an assessment piece that really measures effectively and accurately how much our students are learning. And if we find out that there's a problem in second grade reading or fourth grade math or seventh grade science, we as a state have the ability to change directions on short notice. We're talking about testing two or three times a year, beginning, middle, and end. Right now, we test in October, we get the results in March or April, that year is gone. So we want to be able to establish a test to get those benchmarks at the beginning, midway point, and end. So that the teachers in the classroom that are doing the difficult assignments of trying to educate our kids have an idea how to react to it in real time. So that's something that we're still working on. The resolution that went through is a resolution. I don't believe that it has binding status. I don't think that this is the last time that we're going to be dealing with the statewide assessment. That's why there'll be a bill introduced maybe as early as next week that forces the department to deal with. Develop this list of criteria that Senator Colbeck and I measured. We wanted accountability, we wanted Michigan control. We wanted some benchmarks to be able to be met on what we're going to be expecting. It creates an accountability all the way through the system. So I was not in favor of gambling through something that was that important, but I was also opposed to the fact of moving a major policy conversation and policy debate through an appropriations bill alignment. That's just as dangerous because we didn't have the time to go through and give the amount of attention that was required of developing the proper assessment tool. I'd be happy to answer any questions if any of that resonated with you or not, but it's a very complicated to keep in mind that the standards have already been adopted. 2010, and now we're looking for the proper way for Michigan to be able to assess if that learning is taking place. And oh, by the way, lack of a standard in our state so hard to get. It unravels the ability to rank a school from A to F. If we get that assessment right, it gives us the ability to have more accountability and transparency in our schools. It really measures for one of the first times. Is the $14.5 billion that we spend in Michigan on public education, are we getting a return on that? And how does that return measure up with other parts?
Okay, who has a question for the senator? Right here.
The standards are fine. I love standards. That's great. But there's a lot more to come for. I heard more of the standards. One, there's a school board meeting. You submitted your questions to the school board. They picked what questions they would answer. Someone dared speak up against them. He was arrested for speaking out of turn. They start their textbooks. The Second Amendment is completely wrong in the textbook. You no longer have parents going through and critiquing these books. Common Core sets the curriculum. Johnny has too many. You don't have any favorite books or taught in the school anymore. Basically, you're told to butt out.
That's disappointing. It really is, because you hit on something that's really important. The parents aren't involved. And the parents have to read that homework and read that information. They have a responsibility. If a parent is willing to forego their responsibility in a child's education and just assume the government is going to provide that level of education, you're going to get what you get. The curriculum is not the Common Core curriculum. I have to say that. This is the Common Core state standard. This is a measurement. Now, there are over 46 different programs that have been developed to align to this standard. Interesting. How many of you have been to a school board meeting last year or two? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. That's where the decisions are being made on the curriculum. Steve talked about getting engaged in elections for the right people. How many of you got behind the school board election in the last 4 or 5 years? 3 or 4 or 5? The decision on the Common Core state standard was made at the state level, state board of education. Can anybody name a state board member? Well, who are those people? For the most part, there, with any free society, comes a responsibility. You've got to be engaged in your son or daughter or granddaughter or your neighbor's garden. You have to hold those school boards accountable. There was a vote on the Common Core in Fort Durham. They were moving down the pathway of adopted resolutions urging the legislature to continue on with funding. In Fort Huron, that resolution did not pass. It was a 3-3 vote. There was one member that was absent. That member would have voted no against implementation. But our school districts have curriculum directors. They decide the course of their learning. There is a control mechanism. It isn't as probably powerful as someone navigating the system for the first time might find the system frustrating, but it requires a steady drumbeat to find out what is in the books that our kids are reading. There have been some very extreme cases talked about associated with Common Core, and I don't dismiss any of them. But what we're trying to establish is a way to control the standards through a Michigan system instead of having to be part of a 13 state authority. Let's just assume that we do identify the third grade reading as a big problem. We're missing it. Something just isn't right. We would then have to go to this consortium and lobby to change a test question. That isn't what public education is. That isn't what state rights are. We should be able to handle that. But along with that comes the responsibility to be able to follow through with it and continue to beat that drum. And this is not. The resolution that passed will not be the last time that we deal with this issue. It will come up in statute, it will come up in next year's budget conversation. we pump the brakes right now, we still have an assessment tool in place for the beat test. We're still measuring kids' performances. We have 5 different accountability measures already in place. What would be the problem of coming up with a Michigan solution to the assessment?
Okay, I think we need to thank Senator Pavlov. You have a question for Mr. Tim first.
Senator, thank you for your coming in. One of my concerns is, what about private school people and homeschool people? If this is going to be the standard, and this is going to be what determines whether you will go to college or not, or get into college or not, what about these homeschool, private school that don't have that?
We exempt it. We don't call them homeschool because homeschoolers don't like to be called homeschoolers. They like to be called non-public school students. And that's by design. That's something that they work very, very hard to make sure that they're not listed in legislation. And the reason is if you put your name as a homeschooler, you become a target. All right? Well, you can personally, but you don't want to know that. The associations that pay very close attention to the homeschool movement, the Inch, Citizens for Traditional Values, my phone rings when there's any reference to homeschooling. And to talk more to you about that. They are non-public school students. And that's very important to the movement because here's what happens when you label yourself as a homeschool student. Truancy. Suddenly, any kid that's walking around as a homeschooler, they're not in school. The second thing is the public education system wants to get you into it. And so the first thing they do is they calculate, oh my gosh, there's 98,000 homeschoolers in the state of Michigan. 98,000 have $7,000 each in our public schools. So we're very sensitive to calling them out in legislation because they are exempt. That was my original point about the validity of what a resolution does. I'm operating that isn't going to be binding, so we're going to have to come up with the legislative fix, and that bill will be introduced in the next couple of weeks. There is not the infrastructure to be able to handle that. Part of the challenge with the technology is you're not allowed to be able to use a wireless environment. All of our schools are hardwired, but the last stretch from the hardwire to the laptop is a wireless connection. And so there's security issues there. The criteria that we developed that ended up getting rejected in the last go-around required to put into consideration, we can still do this on a scan front test. It does not have to be a computer adaptive test. And so we put that provision in there so that there's that security. For a school up there, for a rural district, I went down and met with Polk County ISD, probably one of the largest counties in Michigan, with the most amount of resources, and their IT people were telling us, if we have to do this smart balance test, this thing will not down before our eyes. We do not have to backbone the infrastructure implemented. So when we moved to 3 tests, we allowed the district to be able to choose a scan count test. Another reason that another part of the requirements that will be again in the bill we're introducing next week that gives me a possibility.
So please stay tuned for that. We do want to allow a few minutes as well for Representative Daley to come and talk to us.
Thank you
for the invitation. Yeah, and thank you for Senator Pavlov very much.
in the House of Representatives, as you probably know, we did have a voice vote on the Senate floor. First time through, it did pass. Now the Republican vote is passed with the Democrat vote. So I was one of the no votes on that bill. I'm not sure when that wasn't a bill, it was a resolution. But it did pass with 80-some votes, 30-some in opposition to it. So it did pass, and some of the Senate maybe changes that Phil talked about that have to do with the testing coming back. Now, when the bill came back from the Senate back to us, there was a decision by leadership that bill be gaveled through. Again, not a bill resolution, excuse me. But there's a difference between a piece of legislation, a bill, and a resolution, because a bill takes the majority of the elected officials, so it takes 56 of 110 votes to pass a piece of legislation. A resolution only takes the majority of those voting. So even if there was a roll call on that second time vote, and the round of votes only taken a majority of the people to vote. So there's a lot of different things that can happen with a resolution. And whether a resolution, I think, is still mentioned, really carries a lot of real weight. It really doesn't carry the weight that a piece of legislation does. So the second time around, it was leadership's decision that there had already been a roll call vote in the House. The votes were the way they were. They asked us in our caucus meeting if we were going to change our vote. We let them know, and if there was going to be a difference in the vote, they would do a roll call again. But apparently there wasn't, and so they just gambled. That's the way it went together. I got an awful lot of calls and a lot of emails coming from mostly homeschool people, very concerned about Common Core and where this is going, testing and all that's involved with it. And this is where I'm going to be a little bit repetitive of what Phil talked about, basically what Steve said as well. I encourage them all to get involved locally. And, you know, electing your school board members is so important in the curriculum. I'm just as guilty as the rest. I sat back for all these years to send my kids through school. Never went into the board meeting, school board meeting. We've got a very half-had. We've got a little better school board, I think, now than we had in the past, the Pierce School District, anyway, and in some areas of the county as well. We've got to be careful on who's elected. And the other issue that I told everyone, these folks that I've talked to, and I'm still calling them, I've got a list in my car that I'm calling back as I commute back and forth. The other thing is the State Board of Education. Like when Phil asked the question, not very many people really even know who those people are. They're the ones that are making these decisions. And then, of course, the legislature gets their finger pointed at them and they're involved. We're only one vote for those members as well. So it's really important to get involved in those elections and at the local level and at the state level. And I know some people say, well, I'm trying to put a conservative in on the State Board of Education and even make it last time around. But don't get off that. I want to encourage you guys again. How important the Tea Party is to this state, to this country, is unbelievable. Because I'll tell you what, Republicans and Democrats are both afraid of the Tea Party. I was at the But with that, I don't want to keep it too much. I think we've got any questions.
I'd like to say on behalf of the representative and the senator, they made a comment that's very true, and I'm sure you've all heard this, all politics are local. Richard Daley is one of our State Board of Education members that we elected, and he's helping with the Common Core. The local Board of Education, get involved. Doesn't matter your age. You know, most of the boards of education around the state have retired teachers on the boards. So they're just propagating what they've been doing. So listen to what they're telling you. I mean, they're not the only ones that we need to keep an eye on. And I'm not saying like the two of you, I'm not saying that in general.
Don't worry, we're used to it.
But your locals as well. Your township, your city, your county, your school boards. Get involved.
Anybody else? We're going to close the meeting. John, I'm sure. Okay. Well, thank you. Do you have a question from the board? participate. So with that, I think we should close in prayer if you have an opportunity to please stand or stand rather. Thank you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for our time together this evening. Please bless us all with safe journeys home. We thank you for all we have. Please help us to not waste the amazing opportunities that you have placed before us. Please give us the courage to pick ourselves up and get started again whenever we feel discouraged. Please, Father, spark that fire in our hearts so we can feel the passion that keeps us driven to please you and to be better for you each and every day. Help us to pursue our lives as if there may be no tomorrow, so we can live in freedom and liberty to your potential. We ask that you bless us with constant reminders of the motivations we have learned here this evening. We ask this of you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all for coming.